to fling myself into the everyday arms of the people to sing. Oh shadow, you divide me. I cannot be divided. To fling myself into the heart of the struggle without remorse, to end the pain of wanting the old stick of self to be or not. To fling myself into its roaring depths, lose myself in the fists on fire, in the vowels wide open, in the thronging cries, enter the zone of the simple, comradely embrace.
Jack Hirschman has lived and struggled as a committed and uncompromising artist, writing, translating, and publishing over 100 books of poetry over the course of 55 years. He has strived and succeeded in surviving as an artist, which is no small feat in the context of modern urban life.
Jack è un pilastro, ecco, è un pilastro di questa poesia che è una poesia totale, ma vorrei dire in più, che rompe proprio quel muro di separazione tra il privato e il civile.
The simplest thing in the world. Imagine 3 lines in Japan, thousands of leaves of grass of our own American bard, millions of variations throughout the world, even unto intricate rhymes hip-hopping down the street, in schools, in prisons, slipped under your door, on the page or off the page, published between your ears. The simplest thing is the greatest weapon against the chaos, the fear, and war.
Jack, although he might be reading from a text, is not reading it in the sense of like other poets. He's really kind of not quite performing it, right? But declamando the poem, right? He is proclaiming, in a way, the poem.
Made the stained glass holy while cold November rain wrapped fate. I do not lament, for in the poverty of days I am swollen by the full-blown cantos from the mouth of the choir of the bell-ringing dead.
Through his words, Jack conveys the pure, the gut-wrenching, the euphoric, and the tragic elements of human existence. As a political activist, Hirschman has fought against the injustices present in American society and continues to do so today.
Born again death, you Bush with dick and guns, you sheriff with a pussy cummy Texas, hunting down bombshells, kicking Islamic ass, stripping ass, ordering ass to whack off, hot ziggity, it's the all hangout, the naked dick, caught, captured, then captured in the lens again, beaming, well, suck my dick, there's free speech for you. We piss on the Christ in your bush. There's your freedom of religion. The abuse that's torture is of a nature we've never not known. The competitive violence of money exchanging murderers making day night and light darkness.
He's very courageous in that way. He doesn't sort of think, oh my God, the consequences of this. He just writes it and, you know, he reads it.
If it takes courage to look at something, if it's ugly or whatever, I have to go there. I have to go where I'm supposed to go right now. And Jack is very courageous to do that, and he writes a lot, very regularly. But that means he has to go to that place a lot. You've got to, you know, when you look at how prolific he is, that means he's often facing the blank paper, and he's often crossing that bridge, and he's often daring it, and yeah, and it's a lonely journey.
Jack Hirschman has touched many people during his lifetime. Though he lives a private life, Jack is in essence a public figure, meaning so much to so many. Hirschman was born in the Bronx, New York, in 1933. His parents, Shep and Nellie Hirschman, were second-generation Russian Jews. From early on, Jack had a great desire to be a poet.
His mother asked him, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? He said, I want to be a poet.
At 15, Jack began writing and working for local newspapers and then with the Associated Press in Manhattan.
My first brush with the law. The paper was a front for a large bookmaking operation. Two guys in the other room worked a switchboard connected to a larger Yonkers daily newspaper, which in turn was plugged into the Yonkers Raceway. It's big. It's ugly. I hate it. I love it. I'm free. Oh, talk to me. Can't you hear me? I can't leave it. I'll do anything for it. It's so big. It's filthy. It's so sweet. I adore it. I'm staying. I'll never leave. It's in me. It's so cruel. I hate it. I love it. It's mine. I own it. It's mine. Again and again I say, I hate war. I love it. It's disgusting. It's awesome. I love it. I won't go. I promise. It's beautiful. Talk to me. Can't you hear me loving? Oh, it's so brutal. It's so shit. Talk to me. Tell me what I should do. Anything. It's marvelous. I'll never stop loving it. Never, 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 never.
Among Hirschman's poetic influences during his formative years were writers such as Ernest Hemingway, James Joyce, Walt Whitman, Pablo Neruda, and Dylan Thomas. In 1954, Jack married Ruth Epstein, who he had met while attending City College of New York. The couple soon had two children, David in 1956 and Celia in 1958. Hirschman received a BA from City College in New York and went on to earn a master's degree and PhD from Indiana University in comparative literature. During the 1960s, Jack would be greatly influenced by poets Allen Ginsberg, Robert Creeley, and Charles Olson. In 1960, Jack had his first book published, A Correspondence of Americans. After teaching at Dartmouth College for 2 years, Hirschman took a job as an instructor at UCLA in Los Angeles, California. In order to get to LA, Hirschman parted with a prized possession. When he was 18, Jack had written Ernest Hemingway looking for guidance as a writer. He sent him a couple of short stories he had written. Hemingway responded from Cuba, where he was living, with an encouraging letter telling Jack, I can't help you, kid. You write better than I did when I was 19. Jack sold a letter to Indiana University and bought a station wagon with the money. Ironically, upon arriving to the West Coast, Hirschman learned of Hemingway's suicide. The letter appeared in the New York Times.
We headed south in Idaho, riding clear of towns, taking back roads, filling the back of the wagon with sprigs and flowers. Never turned the radio on, never read a headline. We hit California. The newspaper said, "Papa, you were 3 days dead." The cities and towns piled up again. The sun got blinding. She put on dark glasses. I drove slowly through the streets to the end.
In Los Angeles, Jack became involved in a scene of artists centered around photographer and collage artist Wallace Berman, who was to influence Jack's poetry and art. Among Jack's friends at the time were actors and artists Russ Tamblyn, Dean Stockwell, and George Herms.
All around him, I found this flow of these incredible people. They all gravitated. Anybody of any weight in the arts at that time that came to LA contacted Berman. And Jack was one of them.
The Rolling Stones came into town and came up to Topanga, and you know, they go up and see Wallace. He was an incredible influence. Wallace Berman is on the cover of the Beatles album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. I mean, you know, that huge, huge album, and there's a bunch of celebrities on there, and one of them is Wallace Berman.
The key word that Berman gave to Jack, I think, and this is why he does what he does, he says everything he does is personal. You know, you have to keep it personal. You and somehow, so often, so much is impersonal, that is, has more availability. There is something special about being a recipient of something that's, you know, like one of 100 copies.
This is the Love Press. And this is where the books of poetry are printed, one page at a time. And so Jack, this goes on to be an edition of 150, the Love Press Topanga, 1968.
I think Jack was probably viewed by a lot of people as being on psychedelics when he was teaching at UCLA, because his imagination was so incredible, and he was looked upon as being, you know, way out. No one was way out without artificial stimulation. That's kind of was like a given during those periods. But Jack was on the natch. I mean, he was not using drugs. He was high on poetry.
Which moves in stillness, yet is not precisely. In short, is not a knot of negation. Tangled in tongues of shoelaces of spaghetti, in long under the image I was wearing out, we were weaning each other by winks of eternity. Still do. Butterfly lashes, indigo.
As an instructor, Hirschman spoke out against the escalating war in Vietnam, leading demonstrations and urging his students to be politically active in opposing it.
I broke some laws when I was a teacher in this at UCLA, largely due to the Vietnam War.
In 1966, the UCLA administration decided to fire Hirschman for his alleged activities against the state.
I think his days in academia were numbered, you know, even when he came to Los Angeles. You know, the old bromide about those that do and those that can't teach, and those that can't teach become critics, you know. So Jack is a doer, you know. He's an actual living poet who continues to work around the world. He's global. See, he's international.
He now felt that academia was part of corporate America and wanted nothing to do with it.
In a way, the narrow-mindedness of the UCLA faculty who got rid of him, what do they call it, the Academic Senate or something, had, you know, they've been proven to be so provincial and Jack is a citizen of the world.
By the early 1970s, Jack's marriage to Ruth was failing.
The fact was someone had to put food on the table, you know, and that role had shifted.
I am at home, you are at home inside. The children are asleep in their room. Inside, I am working under the lamp of the poem.
It was not the role she had bought into. It was not, she had two small children and a husband, none of whom were able to really provide for her.
Following the couple's separation in 1972, Hirschman decided to move to San Francisco, attracted by its politically vibrant atmosphere and dynamic community of poets.
There was a vibe in San Francisco that was calling people. It was just the spot where it was at the time.
His peers included notable poets such as Gregory Corso, Bob Kaufman, Neely Tchaikovsky, David Meltzer, and Jack Micheline.
Look, North Beach is a place where I've sat in cafes and have sung. You know, sung, not merely read poetry, have sung and have wept and laughed and fought. It's a place that's very dear to me. It's very central in my life.
I lived in those days, when I first came up from San Francisco, after my money sort of ran out, I literally was found by a woman on the, an artist with whom I lived. But literally, I was about to ask her for a buck. I had no money. Instead, she very kindly said, come. In those days, there was a movie house for a buck. You'd see two movies. And I was just sitting on the street there, and she took me to the movie, and we stayed together for 9 years. Kristen Vederhan, she lives here. She lives just across the street.
I think the unsaid deal that they had, Kristen was going to pay the, you know, go work, pay the bills, and Jack was going to support her work as an artist. And he did. You know, he would make try to get her into as many books and anthologies and shows and so on. He was really very supportive of her.
Jack always had that city, that city thing going. It got all of his energy, I think. And that's probably why he moved to, that's why he moved to San Francisco, would be my guess. I mean, I never asked him, but you know, when he went to San Francisco, he was like a street poet. And whenever I'd go visit him, and Dean and I, we would walk the streets. You know, and Jack just loved to, you know, walk the street, not waiting for lights, and with the traffic and everything. And we'd go to a jazz club, and that time we were drinking quite a bit.
You know, in school, you're going to read some Tennyson and some Browning and this and that, and enjoy it, and it's nice. But his poetry, all of a sudden, this no-holds-barred type of stream of consciousness, it kind of blew me away.
For a period of 11 years, beginning in the late 1970s, Hirschman wrote a poem every day in the Russian language.
Akimbami v holos dietvu, kružaja cigankami, vidiete? We are the little laughter within the big body, which sounds like big laugh, but really is little laughter, because we are mountains with echoes and tundras, thus the landscape, though really it is still the little laugh, like a kopeck akimbo in the gullet of childhood, whirling like a gypsy, see?
Jack's work as a translator grew during this period, and Hirschman would go on to translate in 9 languages, including Albanian, Russian, Italian, French, Haitian Creole, in Spanish. Jack became a committed political activist and Marxist. Between 1976 and 1989, Hirschman disseminated roughly 125,000 handmade works of cultural propaganda in the tradition of agitprop activism. In 1980, Jack joined the Communist Labor Party, a group he would stay with until it dissolved in the early 1990s.
I wasn't born a communist. I was made one. I was made one by the things that I saw, the things that I studied, the things that I naturally felt.
Jack came into town, and I don't remember what year, but he did a poetry reading. It was in a big church in L.A., and he read a poem that he'd written on Stalin, and it was sort of like, maybe it was a poem written by Stalin, and he read it, and it was just making him out to be this great human being, and the people started yelling. They started yelling him. They practically yelled him off the stage.
Because Stalin's writings were part of the communist continuum. Others had shrunk away from Stalin's writings and after 1956. But I took a lot of heat from people on the streets and things. I said, you know, they started calling me Stalinist. I was trying to explain you could only be a Marxist-Leninist.
Jack,
15
you're not
to 17. See, now we can't even get a question in. Here comes another guy about Stalin.
Come on, Stalin, Mao, Hitler, even Churchill and Roosevelt. Evil fucking fascists in their time. All the same from the same stripe.
So who wasn't?
Exactly.
No, who wasn't?
Oh, give me your hand, five.
Oh, that mean everyone.
Everybody was fucked up in those days. God, thank God we weren't. We're not adults in those times. What moral choices we would have to make?
But Stalin was the leader.
He's a fucking idiot.
Stalin was the leader of the forces that defeated Nazism.
He was a syphilitic moron. Come on.
That defeated Nazism.
Yeah, but he was worse than Nazism.
Blah, blah, blah.
He killed more.
You know, I've heard that from
of
people.
His own people.
I've heard that from
what
people.
What a fucking asshole.
It's an amazing thing to say.
We used to stand on opposite street corners and yell at each other. Ah, you old commie. Ah, you fucking anarchist.
Which was which?
I mean, the left really has to get away from using these old ideological tags and name tags for political positions.
Take out the Marxism, the Stalinism, all the name calling that goes according to that. But you look at the underbelly of what he's really trying to suggest. What he's really trying to suggest is every human being has a place.
That's one of the reasons I fight for the revolution, not merely to create a more equitable system vis-a-vis the distribution of the wealth of the world, but also that people will recognize that everyone is a poet, and that poetry is the mode of dwelling in the deepest and most spiritual parts of oneself.
In effetti, mi ricordo la prima volta che è venuto in Italia. C'è stata una lettura in un paese, non mi ricordo il nome, poi c'è stata una cena, e dopo cena tutti I compagni italiani cantavano Bella Ciao, Bandiera Rossa, e poi andando a casa ho visto Jack piangere, gli ho detto, cosa c'è Jack, sei ubriaco? Lui ha detto, no, ho capito finalmente che il comunismo è l'unica tradizione classico-moderna dell'umanità.
Mother, we are not in this world. A long time ago it happened. It was over the world war. I took you by the hand through it, tiniest hand, tiniest star. You didn't move, then I was dead, then you were dead. In the open mouth of grief, there is a candle.
David was like a golden boy, you know what I mean? He was one of those extremely talented, gifted kids that can do anything. I mean, this is my perception of it, and there were no barriers to where David could have gone.
In 1980, Jack's son David was diagnosed with leukemia.
David came up to San Francisco, you know, when he was in like a remission, and they bonded, you know, they made peace, and it was very profound for both of them. Because then when David went back, within about a week or so, he died.
When you lose a child, it's... life gets pretty much turned around in a funny kind of way. Death and life, there's a very thin line, actually, between the two, even though it seems that there's a vast gulf.
I am not with my breath. I am the slow peeling away of the skin and all the deaths I've seen registers in my eyes. I have been a laughing tree beside a stove of honeyed bananas. I have been a silver fox and the elegance of heel. I have been what has brought you down and the words you look up. I have been the spit upon and the ganged, the slain and the invincible, the bitch of moons, the whiplash of compassion behind the drug of sluts, the red thread that liberates all convicts, the thimble that balances your jiggers, the kalimba that wraps your nightmares in lullabies, the power of birth when a child dies.
Grief-stricken, Hirschman found solace in his art and political activism. He moved into the Tevere Hotel on Columbus Avenue in North Beach. Soon, Jack began a new relationship with Sarah Menefee, a fellow communist and poet.
When we first got together, he said to me, I have nothing. I don't know how I'm going to live. I don't know what I'm going to do. I said, well, don't worry about it. He was just in a lot of anguish. And I was pretty messed up myself for my own reasons, and we kind of saved each other. I felt that way about it. I got to live in Jack's poetry a lot. It's an amazing place to be.
In 1986, Jack became deeply involved in the growing crisis surrounding homelessness. Upon entering the White House, President Ronald Reagan continued what he had started as governor of California, closing numerous mental hospitals and cutting back on social services. As a result, homeless populations in cities around the United States grew rapidly during the 1980s. Hirschman and Sarah Menefee helped create a San Francisco chapter of the Homeless Union, an organization led by homeless people themselves. Hirschman's poem, Home, written and read in front of the Homeless Union members, is the poem Jack believes is his most enduring work.
Winter has come. In doorways and alleys, at the top of church steps, under cardboard, under rag blankets, or if lucky, in plastic sacks, after another day of humiliation, sleeping, freezing, isolated, divided, penniless, jobless, wheezing, dirty skin wrapped around cold bones. That's us. That's us in the USA. Hard concrete, cold pillow. Where fire? Where drink? Damn stiffs in a drawer, soon if, and who cares? Shudders so familiar to us, shivers so intimate, our hands finally closed in clench after another day panhandling, tongues hanging out. Dogs ate more today, are curled at the feet of beds, can belch, fart, have hospitals they can be taken to. They'll come out of houses and sniff us dead one day. Pieces of shit lying scattered here in an American city renowned for its food and culture.
The Homeless Union was an attempt to organize homeless people to fight for their rights and not just beg and plead for an extra handout.
Yesterday, we reported that two abandoned houses in Oakland were occupied by homeless activists. They remain there today, even though the houses were scheduled to be sold.
Why should they stay here? Because they had nowhere to go.
Homeless went to the federal building in San Francisco this morning, hoping to stop HUD from taking bids on the two houses.
HUD houses for the homeless! HUD houses for the homeless!
The homeless who occupied the house said they were cleaning it up and beginning to live together in peace with strict rules. No drugs allowed, no alcohol, no weapons, and no violence.
He was just, he found his place. He, of course, was homeless himself, or all but homeless. But he found his place as a voice of this movement and gave it tremendous literary fire and tremendous imagery. He really was absolutely galvanizing. And of course, Jack didn't just write poetry. He considers poetry something that should be performed, and he considers his voice as his instrument.
The union didn't last a long time. It was a very volatile situation, really a lot of stresses, very difficult. So it kind of, self-destructed after a year or so.
In the late 1980s, having recovered from the shock of his son's death, Jack embarked on his most prolific period, publishing The Bottom Line, An Endless Threshold. Jack began to receive praise from poets in the United States and abroad. In the early 1990s, Jack initiated a long-lasting friendship with Sergio Iaguli and Raffaella Marzano, who ran a small Italian publishing press. The couple would soon be publishing his work with translations done largely by Raffaella. By the late 1990s, Jack had earned more of a following in Italy than he had in the United States. Began living part of the year in Europe.
Pensato, perché ha pensato, guarda come è ridotto questo uomo.
Oh, a real star movie.
Quando lui viene da me a Marghera, ricordo che si chiude o nella stanza o si mette sul tavolo a scrivere. Comincia a scrivere e finito di scrivere, vuole sempre leggere quello che ha scritto, non importa se noi siamo stanchi, se vogliamo cucinare, se vogliamo fare altre cose, lui deve assolutamente leggerci la cosa che ha scritto. E questo è molto bello perché è proprio il suo amore verso la poesia, ma anche un po' un atteggiamento da bambino, perché come il bambino che ha fatto una cosa bella e vuole subito farla vedere alla sua mamma.
In the late 1990s, Jack's relationship with Sarah Menifee ended. Hirschman had fallen in love with Agneta Falk, a Swedish poet he had known for years. In 1999, the couple married, with his old friend David Meltzer performing the ceremony.
It was very organic and not at all. It was very Jack and Aggie, and it was very lovely. It was a very, very lovely, very who they were, and very life-filled and spirit-filled, and not at all pretentious. And not at all, sometimes weddings are just so worrisome to people when everything has to be like this and like this and like the other. And this was not at all. It was just lovely. It's probably the way weddings should be.
The love poem for Aggie Moo. Bliss of all blisses, lightly you do declare intimacy by putting your lips right here. So this is thought without itself. Spoken though nothing said, nothing when it's everything, naked kiss that shed the crumbs of time in the orgy of pennies thrown and stuck to the mind. And now, alone with one of a kind, a pair of lips, the origin of itself opens in order to reveal there is a language called soul, a tongue that is the kiss that's the bliss of all blisses, untranslatable.
You know, he and his wife shared a tiny, tiny bedroom. And he told me one time, he said, you know, we share the bed when we want to paint. You know, she takes half of the bed and I take the other half and we both paint, you know. There is not enough room for them to walk around.
Soups. In winter, I like soups, these little spicy ramen soups when I make bok choy. I love bok choy. Bok choy is my favorite vegetable. It's Chinese cabbage, really. For me, food is an occasion. I know it's terribly backward, but food is an occasion for me to get back to work. It's just a way to get some warmth and energy into myself to go back to work. It's about 15 feet the length of the room. And I think it's about 10 to 12 feet, if that, except that there are large bookcases and a table, so there's, you know, I'd say it's about 10 to 12, isn't that right? What's your take on it? 10 foot wide by about 15, 16 feet. It's very small.
Living in a hotel for him freed him of all the worries about finance. He could just concentrate on his work.
But the painting encapsulates a lot of my loves. The gesture of abstract expressionist gesture. At the same time, the hieroglyphic form. This looks like a kind of P, and there's something else going on there too. And then there's writing, and then other aspects of script in there too, that are almost abstract line, linear things. So I like this painting, and I've kept it all the years, and I kept it right here. And this is where Aggie and I sleep under this painting.
I'm a little afraid of this, but let's see, because I don't want to drab a whole bunch down. Oh, oi, oi. No, it's gonna, wait a minute. Oi.
It's called Constellation, and it's mainly, I saw it in a kind of iconic way, like an icon. I was thinking of sky. Or you're right to raise that question, because that's not so much done in a free abstract expressionist way, but you have to know I'm really very involved with hieroglyphs for many languages, so Mayan there and there, the Mayan
culture and the Russian language is not merely for the Russian, although it is in Russian, it does have a revolutionary resonance, but I love the Cyrillic alphabet as well. And that is, I don't know, some form of hieroglyph that I was trying to make. And I put it in a sky context, I guess, with the title, Constellation, because I did see it that way.
Now, I don't know what this is, but it's another painting. But this, sometimes I'll do it on these walls. Uh-huh. Sometimes I'll do it in the corridor of the hotel. Let me get up here. This was done in 2003. Mm-hmm. You stand over there, you get an idea. And this is another abstract painting. Where? All right. Yeah. Yeah, friends here, they're Fran and Kat and Jeff are filming here. Okay? Okay, babe. He's gonna pick me up at 6. That really, Pollock pointed the way because he really changed the line. He was the great innovator of the line.
Here we go.
He's a wonderful poet and he's got wonderful delivery. I'll always remember, you know, his, he's got this booming, roaring voice when he reads, you know, his poems, you know, I mean, he doesn't need a microphone, you know?
I generally know Jack through general conversation, and a lot of joking around.
So he's a bit of a joker, you know, and he's got a good singing voice. I think his parents wanted him to become Frank Sinatra many years ago. The only reason he didn't go back was that they said he had to have braces on his teeth. And he said no.
One time Jack came to visit me on the set and I did a scene and it was so great because I did this, it was like a huge fight scene with my father on the show and I started crying and Jack just, he just yelled out, "Kudashaw!" like that and you know, we were taping and everybody turned at him and was like, "What is that crazy man doing?" And it was, I mean, of course, it worked because they couldn't really hear him, but it was just great. It's just like he's just moved by the moment. And, you know, as much as he's not a Hollywood guy, that's what I love about him is that he still has respect for what other people do.
Bigger than the Bible.
Bigger it is. Bigger than the Bible.
E più profondi sia gli arcani. Negli arcani io credo che lui così affondi proprio nel magma del cosmo, cioè nell'universo, metta i piedi e mani e gli occhi e l'anima dentro l'universo, contro il magma incandescente di corpi, di lotte, di vite, di prospettive e di futuro, ecco, dell'universo.
The arcanes stand collectively as Hirschman's magnus opus. Over the years, Hirschman has introduced them at North Beach readings, delivering them with force to an attentive crowd. In 2006, an anthology of the arcanes was compiled and published by Sergio Iaguli's press, Multimedia Edizioni, in Italy. Spanning 1,000 pages, The book collects together Hirschman's most enduring work.
So it's a group of poems, and they're called Arcanes, but each one has a different title, but they're usually called the David Arcane, the San Francisco Baghdad Arcane, etc., and so it goes on.
To Jack, each Arcane is a deep, involved undertaking, often taking days, even weeks to complete.
It's unparalleled, I mean, in a way. It reflects an American literary tradition of writing sort of epic serial poems like Pound's Cantos, Williams's Patterson, Thomas McGrath's Letters to an Imaginary Friend.
Gli Arcani sono il capolavoro di Jack Hirschman e sono uno dei capolavori di quest'ultimo secolo nella poesia mondiale, occidentale naturalmente, perché non si conosce tutto.
You know, all those big publishing houses, they also do poetry publishing, and they also call it, you know, like prestige publishing. In order to, you know, have some prestige in the publishing world, they publish poets, even though they know that they're not making money. But they play it safe. They go for the academics, you know. But they're not interested for a street poet like Jack.
You know, Dean and I used to laugh saying that Jack had picked, like, the absolute worst, hardest profession in the world, which, first of all, is to be a poet, but then to be a communist poet in America, a communist poet, and that's your label, you can't even speak at colleges. I mean, you know, you can't go read anywhere to be a communist poet.
There were many years when I didn't use my art to make money, and they were very difficult, because in this country, you don't make money as a poet. And the only way you can make money is in the university world as a poet. You can make money giving readings, and there's a whole industry that built. But since I was fired from the university and then in the street became a communist, a Marxist, then even a Marxist-Leninist, you don't think that they were going to invite me back into the university. So I was out of luck for many years that way.
Usually you gotta die, and then some PhD candidate somewhere, you know, and then gradually, you know, there'll be interest. But you know, but we're talking about living culture, you know. So I mean, that's and Jack is a great embodiment of just living culture. I mean, he's there doing it on all frontiers. So he's not. Death is not the issue. I mean, it'll be ironic, but it won't stop him, you know. And stop the work. The work continues to circulate, you know, and will. I mean, it's a great body of work. He's the greatest unknown poet in America, you know.
So would you say Jack's poetry is less ideological now?
Oh, much. Well, it's just as committed. It's just as radical. It's more radical than before, I would say, because the times call for more radical writing of all kinds. The challenge for poetry and for poets today is to meet the challenge of the cataclysmic times.
How can you describe Jack Hirschman? This book is a very comprehensive, very even-handed choice from all the periods of Jack's writing career. And I must say we had a hassle on some of the selections. It covers such a large range from the most lyrical to the most political. You could say Jack is both one of the most lyrical and one of the most political poets, who even in his most lyrical can be political. And even if it's political, it can be lyrical.
You know,
know, you grow up in a city like San Francisco, and for that matter, more broadly, the Bay Area, and you think back, I mean, really think back, the early days of Robert Frost in San Francisco, of Robert Louis Stevenson in San Francisco, Jack London, of course, in the Bay Area, of Bierce and Atherton and Sterling. You can go on and on and on, Ginsberg, Ferlinghetti. It's an extraordinary tradition that we have people that are as prolific as Lawrence and Jack that really don't worry about what they say. And they say things that a lot of us wish we could say, and they hold us accountable. I really do believe they have been the conscience of the public. And let me introduce someone that doesn't need an introduction in the city and county of San Francisco, someone that Aaron Peskin agrees is the finest choice and the only choice that could have been made. Ladies and gentlemen, your new poet laureate in the city and county of San Francisco, Jack Hirschman. Jack.
It's not the separating of the arts. Everyone truly does, truly really dwells, lives, that is, poetically, or certainly one would hope so.
In this poem that I'm going to read, it will be on the back cover of that magazine. It's called Path. Go to your broken heart. If you think you don't have one, get one. To get one, be sincere. Learn sincerity of intent by letting life enter, because you're helpless really to do otherwise. Even as you try escaping, let it take you and tear you open like a letter sent, like a sentence inside you waited for all your life, though you've committed nothing. Let it send you up. Let it break you, heart. Broken-heartedness is the beginning of all real reception. The ear of humility hears beyond the gates. See the gates opening. Feel your hands going akimbo on your hips. Your mouth opening like a womb giving birth to your voice for the first time. Go singing, whirling into the glory of being ecstatically simple. Write the poem.
One day, I'm going to give up writing and just paint. I'm going to give up painting and just sing.
I'm going to give up singing and just sit. I'm going to give up sitting and just breathe. I'm going to give up breathing and just die. I'm going to give up dying and just love. I'm going to give up loving and just write.